static books. They are very direct questions, that is theory based questions. So you need not have wide ranging knowledge. You'll just need to have conceptual clarity to answer these questions. So first you need to prepare these questions, the easier ones. For example, polity, modern history, and then economics. And coming to geography, all these topics have core concepts. From these core concepts, if you study well, then you'll be able to answer about 50 to 70 questions. So for the next 30 questions, you need to study these kind of topics only after completing these basic and very easy topics. So your preparation focus should be mainly to finish easy concepts first and then only go for tough concepts. Usually a beginner usually adopts a reverse process. First, he tries to understand the tougher ones, thinking easier ones will be very easy to study in the later parts of preparation process. And finally, in the exam time, you'll end up missing all these questions. And even if these questions are asked, you will not be able to answer most of the questions. So you will lose the game of preparation. So it will be a wiser thing to prepare the easier topics first and then tough topics later. So this question particularly is, I would consider it a tough one because there are a lot of names and facts to remember and it is not easy. So other questions before we have seen, let us go back, which are easy and tough. So this is a question, I would say it is a little tough because you'll not usually have this in basic books. So reading these kind of concepts will kill a lot of your time. And then this question is a very easy question because it is completely based on conceptual understanding of basic concepts. And climatology question, very direct question. This question is very easy if you understand core concepts of climatology. Even this question is very easy ones. So you need to prepare these kind of questions first. This is also easy question. Easy one. Okay. Somewhat tough. This question is a little tough because we know in India there is crop rotation, terracing and windbreaks when it comes to soil conservation. But we don't have a clear understanding about sand fences. So we usually, these kind of questions appear very easy on the surface. But if we try to answer them, we are at greater risk. So these kind of questions are the ones which we need to prepare in the later part of our preparation process. So this is a comparatively easy question, easy ones. So this is a kind of tough question because you cannot keep track of all the names of tribes. So a little tougher one if you are not good at remembering facts, etc. So these kind of questions you need to place for at final stages of preparation, that is first you need to finish easier concepts and these kind of tough ones should be reserved for later stages. So again, I consider this as a tough question. And this is also a very general knowledge based question. So you need to know about these locations. It is not easy to know about all these locations because there are so many locations with various important aspects. So we might end up losing marks with these questions. So if you keep on studying these kind of concepts, you'll lose a lot of time. At the same time, you'll not gain more marks from these questions. So first, at the first initial stages of your preparation, you need not focus too much on these questions. But once if you prepare core concepts, then you can go for these kind of questions. Let us see an example for location based question. Barak, Lohit, Subansari, which of the following rivers flow through Arunachal Pradesh? Again, this is depends on your map works, map skills. So as when you prepare geography, it's always important that you have an atlas or a Google Maps with you so that you can locate these things as during your preparation process. So one more location based question on international perspective. Turkey is located between Black Sea and Caspian Sea. So if you see, Middle East region is a very hot region, that is it is constantly in news. So you need to have a geographical understanding of this region. So you need to see which kind of countries surround countries like Israel, Iraq, etc., which are always in news. And then what kind of seas, names of different seas that surround these regions, rivers that flows through these regions, etc. And then this is a question based on current affairs as well as core concepts of geography, that is El Nino. El Nino is in news, constantly in news. It greatly influences Indian monsoons. So you need to have a very good understanding about El Nino. So certain points which are important for our exam perspective are given in newspapers. So you need to keep track of newspapers to find questions based or points based on these concepts. let us see main syllabus. Until now we have seen prelims. Now let us shift our focus to main syllabus. From main syllabus, we have seen that there are three topics. One is physical, economic, and a combination of various concepts of physical geography. In physical geography, we can divide the concept of physical geography as salient features of world's physical geography and as well as Indian physical geography. And also we see important geographical phenomena such as earthquakes, tsunamis, volcanic activities, which are a part of physical geography. And then in economic geography, we have two important topics. One is distribution of key natural resources and factors that affect location of various industries. And then a combination of physical geography and a combination of various concepts of physical geography like geomorphology, climatology, including all these topics, we'll be able to answer a few questions like geographical features and their locations, and then critical changes in various geographical features. So let us see questions from these topics for a better understanding. So first, physical geography of the world. Again, various questions fall under different headings, multiple headings, but I've placed questions in such a manner that you would find it easy to relate with the topics of syllabus. So first we'll see physical geography questions. What do you understand by the theory of continental drift? Discuss the prominent evidences in its support. This is core concepts of physical geography, that is geomorphology. So it is very easy if you have studied the core books well. So all basic books have these concepts. That is continental drift, plate tectonics, seafloor spreading, etc. So very important topics. You need to be thorough with these topics. And physical geography of India. There is no formation of deltas by rivers on the Western Ghats. Why? Again, this is a logic based question. First, you need to understand how deltas are formed. And based on that, we need to know the nature of rivers that flow towards east as well as west in the Indian Peninsula. Usually there are few rivers that flow towards west. So you need to know the nature of these rivers to answer this question. So it is purely based on the understanding of various basic concepts of Indian physical geography. Bring out the causes of more frequent landslides in Himalayas than in Western Ghats. Again, this is a question related to, I can say, various physical important geographical phenomena. Even landslide is an important geographical phenomena, just like earthquakes and volcanoes. So landslides, what kind of factors influence landslides in Himalayan regions is important. Usually Himalayas is an eco-sensitive zone, that is, it is very vulnerable for quick changes, and it is earthquake prone zone. So it is obviously prone to landslides, and due to dense settlements in recent years, the situation has worsened. So we need to have understanding from different angles. So physical geography, the climatology part of physical geography. Tropical cyclones are largely confined to South China Sea, Bay of Bengal and Gulf of Mexico. Why? So there are many factors that influence the location of influence the location of cyclones and their formation. So we'll first need to understand the core concepts. What do you understand by the phenomenon of temperature inversion? Again, concept is mentioned in all core books. So it is a direct concept from books. So you need to keep track of these kind of important topics, which are given. Usually these kind of topics are given in boxes in some books. All those things given in boxes are important. Important geographical phenomena such as earthquake, tsunami, volcanic activity, cyclone, etc. Even these concepts are a combination of different topics from physical geomorphology. So we need to know geomorphology as well as climatology. Tropical cyclone is a geographical phenomenon of climatology. So two questions from tropical cyclones. The recent cyclone on the east coast of India is called Phelan. This is a strained question, and the answer for this is given on IMD website. So you need to keep track of relevant websites for these questions. There are many other important questions from IMD website, that is Indian Meteorological Department website. I've made a note on these questions. I've posted on my blog. So you can refer my blog poormansfriend.org for these posts. And then geographical features and their location. So it is important to understand this concept, this part of the syllabus. This is a little confusing for a beginner. So I've placed a lot of questions from physical geography under this heading so that it will be easy for one to understand what is geographical feature. Explain the formation of thousands of islands in Indonesian and Philippine archipelagos. So Indonesian and Philippines archipelago is an example for geographical features. There are various other geographical features, like you can say the formation of deserts, etc. We have seen, we'll see that in next question. What are the world's fold mountain systems located along the margins of continents? So world's fold mountains are also an important geographical feature, and based on physical geography, geomorphology, we'll be able to answer this question. And then major hot deserts in northern hemisphere are located between 20 and 30 degrees north and on the western side of the continents. Why? Usually this question has different parts, that is, it involves a combination of physical geography, ocean geography and climatology. We need to gather points from each of these topics to answer this question. So again, this is a logical question based on your understanding. So questions will be in such a way that there will be no direct questions, but the questions will demand conceptual clarity of different concepts. Coming to economic geography, distribution of key natural resources account for the change in spatial pattern of iron and steel industry in the world. Critically evaluate various resources of oceans which have been harnessed to meet the resource crisis in the world. I've mentioned a word called polymetallic nodules. So this will be a major part of the question, polymetallic nodules. And then how does India see its place in the economic space of rising natural resources rich Africa? So this is not only a question from geography concept, it is also a question you can consider under international relations. Usually India and China are fighting for space in Africa. They are trying to dominate by gaining economic foothold in various countries. So in this background, we need to answer this question. As well as to answer this question, we need to have basic understanding of distribution of key natural resources throughout Africa. So we'll see that later. And coming to this first question, account for the change in spatial pattern of iron and steel industry in the world. So again, question based on various mineral resources spread across the world. In place of iron and steel industry, in the next exam, it might be some other important one like gold or diamond. So you need to prepare a list of all these important minerals, and you need to know which location has these minerals in abundance. So a lot of these questions are not directly given in books. They are indirect. You can answer with indirect knowledge. First, you need to have a basic understanding of physical geography, that is the climatic region, as well as kinds of soils and what kind of formation is involved in the process of various landforms. Based on that, you can answer different questions. For example, Himalayas is formed due to tectonic activity, and usually Himalayas are not associated with volcanoes. When there are no volcanoes, there will be less amount of mineral resources available in such regions, but there will be more amount of non-metallic minerals such as calcium carbonate related resources which will be available. So the location and formation of a certain geographical phenomena is also important in understanding the distribution of various mineral resources. So again, you need to have a good idea about geomorphology to be able to understand concepts of distribution of key natural resources. With growing scarcity of fossil fuels, the atomic energy is gaining more significance in India. So this question was asked under the backdrop of Kundankulam atomic power plant in Tamil Nadu. It was a controversy in 2013 and 14. So from that background, and it was a hot topic during that year. So you can see a question coming from a related topic. It is said that India has substantial reserves of shale oil gas, which can feed the needs of country for quarter century. How tapping of resources doesn't appear to be high on the agenda? So this is mainly a current affairs based question, because shale oil and gas is in news due to shale oil boom in USA because of improvements in technology. Shale oil and gas are found from deep inside the earth's interior, that is on the earth's crust, and the extraction requires very sophisticated technology. And such technology capabilities are not possessed by India, whereas advanced countries like USA have already developed such technologies. So under that background, we should try to answer this question. So one more important topic, a lot of questions have been asked from this topic, as well as it is no book as directly mentioned about this topic. We can only see from different websites, we can gather points from different websites and sources. So this topic mainly depends on your understanding of various basic concepts. Let us look with examples. Why did the Green Revolution in India virtually bypass the eastern region despite fertile soil and good availability of water? To understand this question, you need to know what is Green Revolution. Again, what factors influenced the process of Green Revolution? For example, Punjab was a developed state, comparatively developed state in 1960s when the Green Revolution began, whereas West Bengal and other regions were not that developed, as well as there was one major crop called jute which was grown extensively in West Bengal, whereas so a Green Revolution process could not be initiated in West Bengal and other northeastern regions because they were involved in various other economic activities, whereas Punjab was completely dependent on agriculture and it was important for us to quickly become self-sufficient. So Green Revolution quickly spread through western states, whereas eastern states did not adopt this process of Green Revolution. So you need to have multidimensional approach, a multidimensional concepts to understand this kind of questions and answer them. So you need to adopt a multidimensional approach, that is look the question from different angles and understand various background topics and then try to frame an answer for these kind of questions. So this is a link to a website where few questions have been answered by some from experienced person. So you can take a look at this website to understand what kind of questions and how do you answer these questions. Again, not every answer is perfect, but still you'll get an idea on how to answer different questions. So do you agree that there is growing trend of opening new sugar mills in the southern states of India? Discuss with justification. So you need to know what kind of factors influence sugarcane crop initially. So we need to know what are major cropping pattern of sugarcane. Usually sugarcane needs year-long water, which is available in perennial rivers of North India. Whereas in South India, the rivers are non-perennial. So sugarcane production in South is at a disadvantage compared to North. But in recent years, with increase in irrigational facilities and various technological developments, sugarcane is spreading towards the growing of sugarcane crop is spreading across southern states too. So you need to know what kind of government policy is adopted in improving sugar mills, etc. So by having basic understanding, you will be able to answer this kind of question. Analyze the factors for highly decentralized cotton textile industry in India. So you need to know about cropping patterns of cotton, which regions are abundant with this crop, especially Vidarbha region of Maharashtra and Saurashtra region of Gujarat are all important crop cotton growing regions. So we need to see what are the factors that highly decentralized. What do you mean by decentralized? Again, decentralized means less control of central government. So most states are involved in production of cotton textile and cotton industry, in development of cotton industry. So how did states play their own role? What kind of government policy improved cotton production in various regions like Gujarat and Maharashtra? So we need to adopt a multidimensional approach to understand these questions. So changes in critical geographical features. First thing, most of the unusual climatic happenings are explained as an outcome of El Nino effect. So when we talk about geographical feature, even ocean waters is a geographical feature. And when there is critical change in these geographical features, then such a change will become important for our exam. We know that El Nino is associated with hot and cold currents in Pacific Oceans. Usually the normal conditions get reversed, and as a result an event called El Nino will occur in Pacific Ocean. That is, hot water from Indonesia near Indonesia moves towards Peru, as a result bringing certain economic effects on Peru. So we need to first understand what is El Nino. So El Nino is a critical geographical feature which influences the ocean surface water. So I've placed this question under this topic. Bring out the relationship between the shrinking Himalayan glaciers and the symptoms of climate change. So Himalayan glaciers is an important critical geographical features, and any changes there are mainly associated with climate change and human settlements, the influence of humans on such features. Bring out the causes for the formation of heat islands in urban habitat of the world. Again, urban habitat here we can consider as a critical geographical feature simply because they are mostly influenced by various components like vehicles pollution from vehicles, industries, etc. And all these influence the climate of these regions. So you can say this concept as a concept under climate change, but I've simply included under critical geographical features so that you'll have a better understanding of this word critical. So this is simply means the change in the geographical feature very quickly. You can see heat islands are not very old phenomena. They are very new, very recently happening ones. This is simply where if you have a city due to pollution and various greenhouse gases, there will be a huge air mass which surrounds this city, which is very hot. Usually the surrounding regions are very cold, whereas the city regions will be very hot. This is called a heat island. So the formation of heat island is mainly due to greenhouse effect or climate change. So from this you'll understand how climate change and various concepts are related under geography. So coming to books, there are few important books, but each book has its own advantages and disadvantages. So I've considered mainly three books. One is Savinder Singh, which is important for optional, but for mains it is a little extensive coverage, so you need not go too much detail into these topics. And there is one more book called Certificate Physical and Human Geography by Chong Cheng Liang. Hope I pronounced it correct, but you would understand with the pronunciation. And then one more book called Spectrum Geography. So we'll see advantages and disadvantages of each book. So Physical Geography is meant for optional. It is a degree book, so it will deal in depth about physical geography. And this book only has physical geography concepts. All of the concepts are absent, like economic geography and Indian geography are totally absent. Whereas from Certificate Physical and Human Geography, this book is a very old book written in maybe 1990s, I guess. And there are no updates of this book. It is not updated regularly. So various concepts are redundant. That is, they are not updated, and they explain very ancient processes which were analyzed in 1950s and 60s. So this book is not updated and doesn't meet to the current requirements in various angles. So Spectrum Geography is purely based for civil services, and we'll see other disadvantages too. So extensive coverage of physical geography, that is Savinder Singh, gives you a extensive coverage of physical geography. It is meant for optional. So for GS purpose, this would be a little tough to understand because of extensive coverage. You'll not know what to read and what not to read. So good for, and then coming to Certificate Human Geography, it is good for GS because the concepts are very easy to understand, though the concepts are not updated. It is also important for optional. Coming to Spectrum, this is good for GS, good to understand the syllabus of optional subject. This book is mainly designed to understand the syllabus of optionals. It is given syllabus wise according to optional syllabus. But still it is of great use for GS as well, because the concepts given are mainly were asked in previous examination. And then all topics of physical geography present, as I've already told, extensive coverage of physical geography. Some topics, so this book is for, this review is for Certificate Physical and Human Geography. So here, that is Zhang Qiang Liang, doesn't have these important topics of plate tectonics, seafloor spreading and continental drift. So the most important topic is missing from this book. All topics are present in Spectrum. So climatic regions not given in enough detail in Savinder Singh, but climatic regions given with a very detailed explanation in Zhang Qiang Liang. So but it is not, such detail is not important for exam. And here this topic is completely ignored. Very few sentences are given. So again, this is the disadvantage of Spectrum Geography. And then coming to language is okay for beginner. And then it is a 600 page book containing only physical geography, lot of repetition of sentences. Whereas language of certificate, that is Zhang Cheng Liang, is good for beginners. It will be easy to understand. Only 200 pages. This is the biggest advantage. In just 200 pages, the book covers lot of important topics. And the other one is Spectrum Geography is a 1000 page book, a bulky ones, but still the great advantage is it has all the important concepts that are mentioned in syllabus for GS. So it depends on your understanding whether to buy which book. I would personally suggest you to buy Spectrum Geography because it will be easy to get all the topics in just one book. Even Indian geography is included in this book. So let us see in previous exams how was the trend. This book helped in both prelims as well as mains. That is only physical geography contents are covered from this book. And Zhang Chang Leung is very bad for mains because not every concept is given in enough detail, and a lot of topics are very old ones. They are not updated, so it would not be of great help for mains. And good for spectrum geography is good both for prelims as well as mains. And the most important thing is spectrum geography is revised every year so that it will meet the current changing trends. Whereas other two books, they are not updated. Both Savinder Singh as well as Zhang Chiang Leung are old versions. They are not updated year by year, so you will not have important concepts according to changing trends. And spectrum geography has Indian geography, but still the Indian geography which is explained in spectrum geography is not so easy to understand. As an alternative, you can look for Kullar. Kullar is very easy to understand, and all topics related to Indian geography are covered very extensively in Kullar's geography. So finally, I have read completely all most of these books, but I didn't get good opportunity to study this book in detail. But physical geography, I've read the full book, and then spectrum also I've read the full book. Not mean very all the important topics for GS, and I can say spectrum geography is good for the ones who have basic understanding of geography. But for beginners, it will be very hard to understand because the language is very tough and basic concepts are not explained in detail. Whereas Zhang Chiang Leung is very easy for beginner, but for advanced stage, this is not helpful. And physical geography is good for optional, but for GS purpose, you need not have this much extensive knowledge on only physical geography. And if you buy Savinder Singh, you will have to buy a few more books to cover other topics of the syllabus. And again, the same with certificate physical human geography, where you need to buy other books even if you have this book. And then coming to spectrum, if you buy this book, it's enough. And only depending on your comfort levels with Indian geography, you need to go for a Kullar, or you may decide based on your first reading with this book. So it depends on your sole interest on which book to purchase. So I said personally, I recommend spectrum geography. And then very important source is Mrunal.org blog, where Mrunal has explained about various important concepts like factors affecting the location of various industries. This is given in very good detail, and as you already know that Mrunal's blog is very important for your preparation, and the topics here are explained in very easy manner. So you can look at this blog for different topics, especially for economy. So here you'll find some geography topics also, so please go and refer them. And then for Indian geography, as I've already said, first you have to buy spectrum. If you find it easy, you can go with it, or else you can buy Kullar's geography. And for economic geography, Mrunal.org has got good notes, and I'll prepare my own notes and post it on my blog, so you can refer this blog and Mrunal.org for the topics of economic geography. So this is the ending of how to study geography. I've gone very quick, but you can use your media player to slow down the video so that it will play at slower rates. So just give me your feedback whether you liked it, or you found it informative, or you found it tough. So based on that, I can tune my other videos. Thanks for watching, and keep visiting my blog. I'll post some important notes. I'm updating daily current affairs as well, so you would find it important for both current affairs as well as static part, and you will mainly understand how to prepare current affairs notes. And constantly visit Mrunal.org because he has got very good articles as well as YouTube videos which will be very helpful for you in your preparation process. Hope this video helped you. Thanks for watching.